can't walk upon the water, and I can't calm a raging sea.
Ephesians chapter 6. I'm going to take our text. Paul writing to the church of Ephesus. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18, familiar portion of scripture. Probably every preacher that has ever preached has preached from the scripture, taught from the scripture. So Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And to me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Our Heavenly Father, we are thankful that you have given us the Word of God, a living Word, to guide us and to keep us and to equip us for the battle that we fight. Today, Lord, I ask in your name that your Spirit would be here with us, that our eyes would be opened unto your word, that our hearts would receive that you have for us, that when we leave this place, we will leave strengthened, edified, built up in the ways of the Lord. We'll thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to talk to you today for a while about something that we are all engaged in. We are all engaged in spiritual warfare. Now, the impetus for this message is this. Actually, it was several years ago that a friend of mine on Facebook posted this post, and this is how it read. Noted often on Facebook is a reference to prayer warriors. Is there any cause to wonder if the word warrior is a bit scary and a bit heavy in any appeal to those who do not have any particular bent towards spiritual matters? It brings connotation of violence to my ears, and not a good way to attract newcomers to things spiritual. Response would be welcome. So, this gentleman was expressing that it concerned him that people would use the term prayer warrior. Now, it was concerning to him, and perhaps he was reading something negative in that term, because he does not understand what the term means or where it comes from. What is a warrior? It is a person engaged or experienced in warfare. A person engaged in some struggle or conflict. What is a soldier? He's a person who serves in an army. An army? An organized military force equipped for fighting. Military. The armed forces of a country. When we came and gave our hearts and lives to Jesus, when we were born again into the kingdom of God, we were enlisted into the army of the Lord. We are all, as individuals, we are engaged in warfare. We have an enemy. 1st of all, in the first place, we have a warfare that goes on with each of us every day as an individual. There is a warfare that we fight between the flesh and the spirit. We're engaged in this. So when we were born again, we were enlisted into the army of God. If you look at 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3, and here Paul the apostle is writing to Timothy. This describes whose soldier we are. To Timothy he writes, "You therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." Whose army do we belong to? Whose soldier are we? We are soldiers of Jesus Christ. No man that wars entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier. If you join the armed forces of Canada, you are going to have to live by the rules or regulations or what have you of the armed forces of Canada. If you are going to be a good soldier, you will have to learn to follow direction. You will have to learn to do something that most of us really don't like to do. You got to learn to take orders. Anybody here enjoy taking orders? Kind of grates on you, doesn't it? But when you are enlisted in the army, that's the way it is. And if you are to earn respect, if you are to earn commendation, if you are to earn decorations as a soldier, you learn to please your commanding officer. You learn to follow his or her direction. In this army that we are in, we were called by Jesus Christ and enlisted in his army. He chose us to be his soldiers. He does not want us to be entangled with the affairs of this life, that we may please Him who has chosen us to be His soldier. We are in this life, and there are things in this life that we must deal with and that we must take care of. There are other things in this life that we need to disentangle ourselves from, that we need to find out what it is that this captain of the host, our Lord and Savior, Lord, what is it that you want of me? How is it that I can please you as a good soldier? And when you make it your life's goal, and when you have fixed it in your mind and fixed it in your heart that I am going to follow Jesus, I am going to live a life that is pleasing and is honoring to Him. I am going to live a life that will bring praise and bring glory to Him. Then you can rest assured that you have an adversary that is going to do everything in his power to hinder you from accomplishing that goal that you've set out to accomplish. And you will be engaged in battle. And he will come against you in all types of manner in an effort to pull you down. And so, we have become soldiers, desirous of pleasing Him that called us to be a soldier. And so we're engaged in this warfare. There is the battle between flesh and spirit. You know, if we look over in Galatians, Galatians chapter 6. Oh, I'm sorry, chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. We look there in verse number 16. Paul the Apostle writing to the church of Galatia. He's writing to them. He's saying this. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Our flesh lusts after things. It desires things. It's what draws us away from Christ, is the lusts of the flesh. It's why the world today is full of people who are lovers of pleasure more than they are lovers of God. Because it is the flesh that draws them. The flesh loves to be pleased. The flesh is pretty easy to please the flesh. If you want to know how to please the flesh, just do whatever the flesh feels like doing. And the flesh will be well pleased. But it will not bring peace. It will not bring satisfaction. And so, he goes on, he says, for the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. He's talking about that battle that is between the flesh and spirit. It's not easy following Christ. You know, we sometimes preach salvation to people, and we preach to people, you know, you come and you give your life to Christ and everything's going to be coming up roses. We've all come to find out that that's not really how it works. What did Paul say to Timothy? Timothy, endure hardness. He didn't say it was going to be easy. He didn't send Timothy an MP3 or a WAV file that says, I beg your pardon. I never promised you a rose garden. He didn't promise that it would be easy. Timothy, endure hardness. It's not easy being a follower of Christ. And in the world that we are living in today, it's becoming harder. Because the world is against us. The world is against Christ. And so, Paul writes to him, and he's talking to him, to Galatians. The flesh, it lusts against the spirit. You have to decide, who am I going to follow? Am I going to follow after Christ, or am I going to follow after my flesh? Am I going to do what Christ wants me to do, or am I going to do what I want to do? I know I'm just going across the surface. I'm not really digging down into the works of the flesh, but we'll read what they are. He goes on and he says, but if you be led of the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now this is what happens. The flesh produces works. The Spirit of God produces fruit. And he goes on and he says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. This is how you can tell the works of the flesh. This is what the flesh does. This is what the flesh brings forth. When you walk after the flesh and after the lust of the flesh, it brings forth adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. Of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. That's what the flesh brings forth. If you walk after the flesh, that's what will come out of there. Now, I'm not saying that you're going to be guilty of doing all of those things. No, I'm not saying that. No, not everybody that does not serve Christ and doesn't know Him are involved in everything that's in that list. But undoubtedly, they're involved in some of them. They're doing some of those things. No, not everybody that doesn't serve Christ and who doesn't know Him and has not met Him, they're not all murderers. They're not all hateful people. They're not all drunkards. They're not all adulterers. They're not all fornicators. But some of them are covetous. Some of them are envying. Some of them are, you know, there are some of them who are hateful. There are some of them that they bring those things out. Because they're walking after the flesh and they're doing what the flesh desires them to do. And those that do those things, those that walk after the flesh, they will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit, the work of the Spirit of God in your life when you follow after Christ and you are laboring to do the things that He desires you to do, that you may please Him who has called you and chosen you to be a soldier. When you are walking after Christ, As long as you live in the flesh, you're going to have trouble with it. You're going to fight with it. This battle is going to go on until you are redeemed and taken home to glory. You will fight with the flesh. It isn't ever going to stop. But if you will walk after the Spirit, set it in your heart and in your mind that, Lord, I want to please you. I want to do the things that you want me to do. You're not going to wake up one morning and find yourself perfect, without fault. I get news for you. Kenny is a long way from perfect. I'm a long way from being fault-free. I'm a long way from having 100% defeated the flesh. But I want to live every day to the best of my ability to keep my flesh under and to walk after the Spirit of God and do the things that please Him. But the fruit of the Spirit is this, is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. So you see, we've got to choose to walk after the Spirit. We've got to choose to do the things that He wants us to do. I cannot promise you that you're not going to have days that the flesh gets the better of you. But when it does, don't lay down in the dust. Don't roll around in the mud and stay there and go on being defeated. Don't give up. Don't say, I guess it's over. I guess I can't do this. Pick yourself up and say, oh, my Heavenly Father, please forgive me. And after that, one of the most important things that you can do is put it behind you. Move forward. Don't let it drag you down. Because God wants you to fight on. And the battle is not over. Live to fight another day. Stand to your feet. And say, I'm going to go on. You might have knocked me down, devil, but you're not going to kill me. I will endure hardness as a good soldier. I will win this battle. Not in my own strength, but in the strength of God's Word. And so we know we have an enemy. So we as an individual, we have this war that is going on between flesh and spirit. But there is a larger war at play. And we see it being played out in our nation and in other nations around the world. You see, one of the things that I am 100% convinced of, I am 100% convinced, and you will not move me from my belief that this book here is 100% true. Amen. That this Holy Bible,
yes,
is wholly true.
Yes.
There is not a word, a promise, a commandment in it that is not true.
Yes.
What it says, it means. It is the only book that we have that reveals to us our God, His character, and His will for our lives. There's not another book that you can read that will give you that information but this book. I am 100% convinced that it is the true living word of the true and living God.
Amen.
Now here's how the battle is getting fought in our world. It's being fought in our schoolhouses.
Yes.
Oh no, you say, oh. Oh yes. The Word of God tells me in Genesis chapter 1 that in the beginning,
that's right,
God,
that's right,
created the heavens and the earth. Mm-hmm. It tells me that He set the sun and the moon in their orbits.
That's right.
He flung the stars into space and He named them. He knows where every one of them is, and He knows what every name of the stars are. Yes, even does. The ones that we haven't named, He knows.
Hallelujah.
I believe that He created the fish in the sea.
Yes, yes.
The birds in the air.
Yes.
The cattle. The worms. The bugs. The spiders. The mosquitoes. The rodents that run through my house. He is the creator of them all. And I believe that He created you and that He created me. He is the creator of man. I believe that when Genesis says that God took something out of the ground and from it that He created a man, and that He breathed into that man, and that man became a living soul.
Yes.
I believe that to be the truth.
Yes.
You can't move me from that. Mm-hmm. I believe what David said in the Psalms, that we are the sheep of His pasture, mm-hmm, that it is He who has made us,
yes,
and not we ourselves. I believe that when God made us, when He made mankind, now right about now would be when our Prime Minister would correct me and tell me that it's people kind.
Yeah.
When God made us, He made us male and female.
That's right. Yeah.
The world would get mad at me for what I'm about to say. If you were born with a Y chromosome, you're a male. You were born with two X chromosomes, you're a woman. That's how God made you. Society today says, no, that doesn't matter. This is where we are in a spiritual battle. The world out there, when children go to school, they're being told that this universe that you see, that was all caused by a Big Bang.
Yeah.
Well, you know, if it was, who made the bang? They're telling your kids in school, your grandchildren, that you started out as an amoeba. A little organism that crawled up out of the water. And then it began to change. And it eventually evolved until it became some kind of a primate. And then from that it turned into a man. The only problem I have with that idea of evolution is that evolution is a theory. But they're telling their kids that it's a fact. Not a fact, it's a theory. Here's what I understand about evolution. I don't believe that people evolve. Things will evolve, but not people. I don't believe the animal kingdom is evolving, but I do believe things are evolving. How many of you have a smartphone? Anybody here got a smartphone? You can hold in your hand a little. It is basically, it's a computer. And it has tremendous power to do a lot of things. But if you go back 35, 40 years ago and try to hold the first computer they made in your hand, you would have to have a mighty big hand. Because it took up a great amount of space. You see, the computer has evolved. I drive a 2014 Nissan Pathfinder. If you go back to 1999 and look at a 1999 Pathfinder, if you set it alongside of the 2014 model that I drive, they wouldn't look very much alike. Because the automobile has evolved. When Henry Ford made the Model T, as far as I know, it didn't look anything like the Fords that they have down at Downey Motors on the showroom floor. They've evolved.
Yes.
But I tell you what, if you could go back to the earliest photographs that you could find, where they took photographs of men and women, you will find that they still look pretty much the same. Now, they may have dressed differently.
Yeah.
They might have had funny hats. Not beautiful ones like Sister Wanda wears. They might have wore different breeches than what we wear today. I can't imagine having to live with a pair of pants with a button-up fly. But the people look pretty much the same. The men, when they reached a certain age, they grew facial hair. They had to shave it off. And the women, unless they had some hormonal problem, they didn't grow beards. Now, I do feel for women. There are women who do have a hormonal issue that causes them to grow a beard. And I feel for them. I do know a woman that has that issue. And I feel for them. But we're still looking pretty much the same. And I doubt very much that if you were to go back to Moses' time, that they probably look pretty much, you know, as a human being, as we do now. And it's always troubled me that if we evolved from monkeys or from apes or whatever, how come there's still monkeys and apes? You would think that whatever came before you, if you evolved from that, that it would disappear. But it's still here. But we see these things, and this is the battle that we are fighting when we are fighting against the things of the world. Now understand something, that there is what we are fighting against. I got to move along because we're running late. But we have an adversary. The devil is our adversary. And he's moving against us. And you see this battle against the church. And you see the issues of human sexuality that we see that the world is imposing upon us, and they are contrary to what the Word of God says. And we are being told that if you disagree with these things, you are hateful.
Yes.
We don't hate anybody. God didn't call us to hate anyone. He called us to love all. But the truth is the truth. And the Word of God is true. If you don't support abortion and euthanasia, well, then there's something wrong with you. You need to be silenced. You need to be put quiet. God's Word is against those things. And if you stand for God's Word, and if you believe what the Word of God says, then you have an enemy. Now let me make something clear. I am not saying that every person out there in the world is your mortal enemy or is out to kill you or get you or whatever. I'm not saying that they are possessed of the devil because they disagree with the things that I'm saying. But they are being influenced by the spirit of the world. That spirit that works, as the scripture says, in the children of disobedience.
Yes.
Where was I reading that? Ephesians 2. And you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and sin, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. You see, the people out there in the world that are not born again, they don't realize the spirit that's working in them. And it's not working to do them good, but it's working to destroy them. Among whom also we all had our conversation in time past in the lust of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. We were by nature children of wrath. Because of Adam's fall, when we were born into this world, we were born sinners. You've heard me say it before, but I'll say it again. Nobody has to learn how to sin. It comes natural. But God has called us out of that when we were born again. And so what is working in the children of the world, they don't know that they're wrong. They don't know that they're being led by the spirit of the world, and that the spirit that they're being led of is leading them to destruction. That's why we need to preach the gospel. But we are in this battle. And so how do we win? We have to do as, and I've got to move quickly. Ephesians, going back to Ephesians 6, we need to see here that first off, what Paul is telling us to do is that we have got to be strong in the Lord. Number one, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. He didn't say be strong in yourself. He didn't say it in the power of your own might, but in the power of His might. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God. Don't put on part of the armor of God. Put on the whole armor of God. Put it all on. That you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. He's identifying your adversary. The devil, he is your adversary. Peter identifies the same one in 1 Peter 5 and 8, when he says, "Be vigilant, for your adversary, the devil, goes about seeking whom he may devour." He's going about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He's your adversary. The lost and those who are out in the world, lost, not born again, not saved, they are not your enemy. They are being led by the enemy to their destruction. We are not their enemy. We are to be their friend. Not a friend of the world, but a friend to the world. Show them the gospel. Show them the love of Christ. And so we put on the armor of God, for we are engaged not in a carnal battle, but we are engaged in a spiritual battle. When the world comes against us, and when the devil chooses to attack you, more than likely he will use some form of carnality to come against you. But our response is not to be carnal. We don't respond with carnality. We need to respond the way that God wants us to respond. And so we need to understand that we need to have on the whole armor of God, that we will be able to withstand in the evil day. We're living in evil times. We need the armor of God on. We need to understand what it is. We don't have time to go in and describe it all today, but he's saying, "Stand therefore with your loins girt about with truth." What is truth? One place in the Bible it says, "Thy word, O God, is truth." Mm-hmm. We need to know the truth of God's word, and we need to gird ourselves with the truth of God's word and the truth of what it says. Having on the breastplate of righteousness. Now you'll notice that there's a word missing there, and I'm glad that it's missing there, because it's a word that I don't want to be there, and it's a word that God doesn't want to be there. Having on the breastplate of righteousness. The word that is not there, and that shouldn't be there, and that we must not allow to be there, is self. We do not want to put on the breastplate of self-righteousness. We want to put on the breastplate of righteousness. Mm-hmm. God's righteousness. How do we find that righteousness? We learn the righteousness of God in His Word. And he goes on, "And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Take the helmet of salvation." A helmet goes on your head. A helmet protects the brain. Helmet of salvation protects the mind. We need to have the mind of Christ. To have the mind of Christ, again, it goes back to, you need to be in the Word. You need to be seeking God. You need to be seeking His will for your life. You need to be talking to Him on a daily basis. You need to be bringing Him all of your troubles and all of your things that are going on in your life. But not only do you bring Him your troubles, you bring Him your praise, and you bring Him your worship, and you lift Him up and you exalt Him. And when you do, you see that God is bigger than your troubles. You see that God is more powerful than your troubles. "And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God." Now here's where we need to come to. We need to recognize this. This is what every Christian soldier needs to be aware of. 2 Corinthians in chapter 10. We've got to have our armor. We've got to know who the enemy is, who we're fighting against. We're fighting against the devil. That's who our enemy is. So we put our weapons on. And now we have to stand strong against the enemy. And how are we going to win against him and defeat him? And this is where we want to see what our weapons are. And again, Paul is talking to the church of Corinth. We'll pick up in the third verse of the 10th chapter of 2 Corinthians. For though we walk in the flesh, we walk in this flesh until we have been raptured, until we, this flesh puts on immortality, we are going to walk in this flesh. But we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. The world uses carnality against us. They call us names. They make plans to rule against us. No. They do things to make it hard on living the Christian life. But the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that it exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. We want our thinking to be God's thinking. We want our desires to be God's desires. We want to cast down our imaginations. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Then the Christian's weapons, if they are not carnal, then what must they be? Our weapons must be spiritual. We are not fighting a carnal battle. Though the world may fight carnally against us, our fighting needs to be done differently. This comes back to that first thing that I read to you that the man posted on Facebook. The term prayer warrior. How are we going to defeat the enemy? We are not going to defeat the enemy by argument. We're not going to defeat the enemy by parading around with signs. We're not going to defeat the enemy by protest. We're not going to defeat the enemy by name calling. We're not going to defeat the enemy by doing any of the things that the flesh likes to do. We can call for the changing of laws. But you know what? You can change all the laws that you want. But only God can change the man's heart. And change, and that's what needs to happen. It's not law changes we need, it's heart changes. If we can change the hearts of people, things that are not right will become right with a changed heart. And so how do we defeat the enemy? And it goes back to Peter said, be vigilant. Be vigilant. Soldiers on watch. You don't want a sleeping soldier on watch. You want a soldier that's wide awake. A soldier that's aware. A soldier that can see the slightest movement. A soldier that can recognize the enemy. Be vigilant. Sometimes our enemy shows up looking real nice, looking real good. We got to be careful. We got to be aware of our enemy and know how to recognize our enemy. So be vigilant. And pray always. Praying always. seeking God's will for our lives, that we would be all that we can be for Him. Using the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. If you go back to Matthew chapter 4, and you read about the temptation of Jesus, and you read His answer to every suggestion of the enemy, how did Jesus answer him? It is written. That is the importance of knowing your Bible. That is the importance of praying always. That is the importance of being vigilant. Because you have an adversary. We are engaged in a warfare. We are engaged in a battle. And as time goes on, it's not becoming easier. We know that the end is approaching. We don't know when the end is. It could be before this day's over that Christ may come. It could be before this year. It might not be before the end of this decade. But we don't know. We do not know when Christ will come. But we know that the end must be drawing near. So, we need to be aware.